Good afternoon, and welcome to this fourth showcase panel on textualism and statutory interpretation. As usual, the Federalist Society has assembled a distinguished panel of experts to discuss this topic. In recent years, textualism has come to replace legislative history as the most important tool available to judges when interpreting statutory text. This panel will examine the new textualism and debate its merits. Some of the questions to be addressed by this panel are, what are the arguments for and against textualism? When, if ever, ought a judge to consider legislative history? This panel will also address the question whether judges share the same approach to statutory interpretation or diverge in predictable ways. The panel will also address what effect, if any, does the choice of interpretive techniques have on congressional drafting of legislation. I will introduce each of the panelists, then they will come forward to speak for about 10 minutes. We'll have some discussion among the panel before we then open the floor to questions and answers. Our first panelist is Professor William Eskridge. He is the John A. Garver Professor of Jurisprudence at the Yale Law School. His primary legal academic interest has been statutory interpretation. Together with Professor Philip Fricke, he developed an innovative casebook on legislation. He has published a few dozen monographs and casebooks. His current casebook project with two of our other panelists, Professors Victoria Nurse and Abby Gluck, is Introduction to the Regulatory State, tailored to first-year courses introducing students to legislation and administration. Professor Eskridge has published more than 100 law review articles. His current project is an empirical and normative analysis of congressional overrides of almost 300 decisions of the Supreme Court of the United States in statutory interpretation matters from 1967 to 2011. Professor Eskridge received his BA summa cum laude from Davidson College, his master's in history from Harvard, and his JD from Yale. Our second speaker, John F. Duffy, is the Samuel H. McCoy Professor of Law and the Armistead M. Dobie Professor of Law at the University of Virginia School of Law. Professor Duffy teaches torts, administrative law, patent law, and international intellectual property law. In the field of intellectual property, Professor Duffy has been identified as one of the 25 most influential people in the nation by the American Lawyer and one of the 50 most influential people in the world by the United Kingdom publication Managing Intellectual Property. After receiving an undergraduate degree in physics, Professor Duffy served as an articles editor on the University of Chicago Law Review and was awarded an Olin Fellowship in Law and Economics. Professor Duffy clerked for Judge Stephen Williams on the United States Court of Appeals for the D.C. Circuit and for Justice Scalia on the Supreme Court of the United States. He served as an attorney advisor in the Department of Justice's Office of Legal Counsel and practiced law with the Washington, D.C. firm Covington & Burling. Professor Abby Gluck is an associate professor of law at Yale. She is an expert in civil procedure, legislation, federalism, state and local government, and health law. She has extensive experience working as a lawyer in all levels of government. Professor Gluck served in the administration of New Jersey Governor John Corzine as the special counsel and senior advisor to the New Jersey Attorney General. She also served in the administration of New York City Mayor Michael Bloomberg as chief of staff and counsel to the Deputy Mayor for Health and Human Services, senior counsel in the New York City Office of Legal Counsel, and deputy special counsel to the New York City Charter Revision Committee. She earned BA degrees in English and International Studies from Yale, summa cum laude, where she was editor-in-chief of the Yale Herald, and her JD from Yale Law School. She clerked for then Chief Judge Ralph Winter of the United States Court of Appeals for the Second Circuit and for Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg on the Supreme Court. Her recent writing has used federalism as a lens through which to study both statutory interpretation theory and health law. Victoria Nurse is a professor of law at the Georgetown University Law Center. Professor Nurse has published widely on constitutional history, the separation of powers, legislation, and criminal law. Her latest article on Congress, A Decision Theory of Statutory Interpretation, was published last year in the Yale Law Journal. Professor Nurse began her career in New York, clerking for Judge Ed Weinfield and practicing at the Paul Weiss firm. She left private practice to serve as junior counsel to the Senate Iran-Contra Committee under Senators Rudman and Inouye. She then moved to argue appeals for the Department of Justice and concluded her career in practice as a senior advisor to the chairman of the Senate Judiciary Committee and now Vice President Joseph Biden, and worked on a variety of legislative matters. Professor Nurse is the director of the Georgetown Law Center's first center on congressional studies. She earned her BA from Stanford and her JD from the University of California, Berkeley. Frank Easterbrook, our final panelist, is a judge of the United States Court of Appeals for the Seventh Circuit and senior lecturer at the Law School of the University of Chicago. He was chief judge of the Seventh Circuit from 2006 until earlier this year. Before joining the court in 1985, he was the Lee and Brenna Freeman Professor of Law at the University of Chicago, where he taught and wrote in antitrust, securities, corporate law, jurisprudence, and criminal procedure. He has published The Economic Structure of Corporate Law with Daniel Fischel and about 100 scholarly articles. He served as co-editor of the Journal of Law and Economics from 1982 to 1991 and as a member of the Judicial Conference's Standing Committee on Rules of Practice and Procedure from 1991 to 1997. Before joining the faculty of the law school in 1979, Judge Easterbrook was Deputy Solicitor General of the United States. He holds degrees from Swarthmore College, a BA with high honors, and a JD from the University of Chicago. Without further ado, Professor Eskridge.
Well, it's a great honor not only to be here and on such a distinguished panel, but also to follow the J. Harvey Wilkinson-Randy Barnett debate about what the rule of law requires of judges. And Judge, I actually want to suggest that there is not such a deep dispute between textualism and the use of legislative history. And I would suggest that looking at history of the Constitution as well as of statutes is a very useful way to cash in on the value of textualism, but to avoid some of the lack of restraint which Judge Wilkinson was arguing about. So the topic of my talk is going to be the possible values of legislative history. And here's what I mean by legislative history. It's the internal history of a legal directive. So it could be the Constitution, rule, a statute, from the introduction, perhaps in an earlier session of Congress, through the enactment. It includes the evolution of the text within the internal process of Congress, along with revisions. It includes the deliberation, including explanations by committee reports, by sponsors, et cetera, often responding to reasonable objections. And it includes the actual votes, including amendments and materials that are rejected. So looking at constitutional interpretation, and this adverts back to the Wilkinson and Barnett debate, how might we take some of the soupy provisions of the Constitution that Wilkinson was emphasizing and cash them in the ways that Professor Barnett was emphasizing? And I think one way of doing it is looking at legislative history. This is an established methodology at the U.S. Supreme Court level, and in some of the leading doctrinal cases of the U.S. Supreme Court, legislative history is freely invoked. For what purposes? One, what does the text mean? This is certainly relevant to textualism. Well, one way you can think about what text means is to look at the original discussions by the Congress proposing an amendment or the states that are ratifying it. And this is the methodology of City of Bernie versus Flores, for example. When Justice Kennedy was trying to articulate the meaning of the to enforce clause of the 14th Amendment, he looked very critically at what was rejected in the House of Representatives, the Bingham proposal, which would have added a necessary and proper clause to the 14th Amendment. And that was rejected because it would have given judges too much power, too much substantive power, and from the discussions and the rejection, Justice Kennedy drew the more limited observation that this was a remedial power given to Congress, and it probably also generated his idea of here's the way we're going to articulate it through this congruence and proportionality test. It was instructive, it was law-like, and it gave some specificity to the way the court articulated a constitutional provision. You can also learn about a lot about constitutional structure. What do these constitutional provisions have in common? Article 3, Section 2, that's the heads of jurisdiction provision. Article 4, Section 2 is the privileges and immunities clause. Section 4 is the Republican guarantee clause. What about Article 1, Section 8, the articulation of the grounds of congressional power, and then the 10th Amendment protecting the states? What do they all have in common? Well, if it doesn't occur to you immediately, you might want to read the Prince case and Justice Scalia's articulation of the original discussions, which focus around the issue of state sovereignty. And Justice Scalia says, if only when you read the Federalist Papers and these original discussions, you come away with a clear idea that in contrast to the Articles of Confederation, what these all stand for is the notion of state sovereignty. States have citizens, states retain some degree of sovereignty, and that's an important principle in a number of cases, not just the Prince case, but also the next case decided right before it, New York versus United States. And that is in thinking of not only about the structure of the Constitution, how things fit together, and the words of the Constitution, what they might mean, but also the principles and purposes of the Constitution. And so in New York versus United States, Justice O'Connor, writing for the court, interpreted the 10th Amendment to protect states against commandeering in light of the Philadelphia Convention's rejection of the New Jersey Plan, which would have retained much of the article structure, and then the ratifying convention consensus that Congress would act on individuals and not the states. And I refer you to Professor Prakash's excellent article on that topic. So what can we deduce from the legislative history of the Constitution? One meta-principle that we might deduce is that this serves at least as a potential constraint upon judicial activism. And I do agree with Judge Wilkinson that one of the problems the District of Columbia versus Heller is an interpretation of the Second Amendment that not only rewrites the amendment to drop the prefatory clause, but it's also in the teeth of the legislative history of the Second Amendment as Madison and Congress drafted it in the period right after the Constitution was adopted. So it adds a level of skepticism against the Heller decision and the suggestion that maybe it's an activist one. So I repeat, the values for statutes are very similar. So what might legislative history help us as a textual theory of statutory interpretation? Number one, it might help you understand the original meaning of statutory texts, the structure of the statute, statutory principles and purposes. Now, I want to use as my text for this, and this is why I'm using PowerPoint, so that you can have the text in front of you. This is like red meat in front of piranhas, to mention the Holy Trinity case. The Holy Trinity case involved the following statute, the Alien Contract Labor Act of 1885. Section 1 says, it shall be unlawful for any person, company, etc., in any manner whatsoever, to prepay the transportation or migration of any alien under contract or agreement to perform labor or service of any kind in the United States. The Holy Trinity Church had imported a rector from England who was an alien to minister to the flock. Does the prepayment of this alien's transportation violate the act, labor or service? Supreme Court said no. Many distinguished commentators, including members of the Federalist Society, have said yes. Well, let's look at this as a textual matter and see if legislative history can actually help us think about this phenomenon. Now, what does labor or service of any kind mean in 1885? Well, you can look at dictionaries of the era, and you see that labor can mean a number of things. It can either mean physical toil, but it can also mean intellectual exertion. Now, labor or service of any kind, you would think, would be a broader understanding than maybe just labor or service simpliciter. Well, another source of thinking about what the words or the phrase mean would be, how is this term used by the legislators in 1884 and 1885? I mean, if you want to know what is the ordinary meaning of the language, you might want to look at the way the legislators used ordinary meaning. And Carol Chomsky has done exactly this in probably the most thorough examination of the legislative history of that statute. She found that in either in all or almost all the instances where labor or service were used in the legislative debates, it was being used to think about manual labor. It was never used to include ministers, et cetera, et cetera. And that, maybe not dispositive, is certainly some evidence of what labor might mean. But further, Section 5 of the statute exempts from the entire statute actors, artists, lecturers, singers, domestic servants. Now, some interpreters have inferred from the list of exemptions the proposition that professions that are not listed, like ministers, are included within the rule of Section 1. Now, what about the question, what does Section 5 exempt? What about lecturers? Now, I've been teaching this for 30 years, and I've traditionally thought, well, lecturers, they're thinking about Chautauqua lecturers. But then Professor Nurse, this panel, discovered, well, where did this come from? Where did this exemption come from? It was an amendment offered by Senator Morgan to add lecturers to the exempted parties. And when asked, well, what are you exempting? Here's what Senator Morgan said. People who can instruct us in morals and religion and in every species of elevation by lecturers are not prohibited. In other words, they're added to Section 5, so they will not be prohibited from entering the country. So what does lecturers mean? Might not the discussions in Congress about what lecturers meant to the people offering the amendment in public representations, might that not be useful evidence in understanding the textual meaning of Section 5's exemptions of lecturers and all these other occupations from the statute? So we start with that legislative history in one of the great chestnuts of statutory interpretation. One of the most criticized opinions in the history of the U.S. Supreme Court, almost always from a textualist perspective. But if, from a textualist perspective, you also look at the way people used words in 1885 when the statute was passed, because remember, most of the critics are more than 100 years later, then you might question how dogmatic you want to be about whether or not there's a plain meaning to the statute. But that's not all. Every statute has a structure. Even something as ridiculously short as this statute, it's less than one page in the statutes at large. It has about 5 sections. There might be a 6th in there, you know, effective dates section. There are just 5 sections. Section 1 is the one that I've quoted for you already. It barred the importation. Section 2 nullified the contracts. Section 5 is the exemptions. And Section 4 is this very interesting section, which no one ever talks about. Section 4 of the statute bars the master of a ship from knowingly bringing any alien laborer, mechanic, or artisan who had entered into a prohibited Section 1 contract into this country for labor or service. Okay, that's Section 4. Now, that's not talked about by the critics of Holy Trinity. And when I first read the statute, I was maybe the first professor actually to have read the statute. The first thing I thought was, Justice Scalia and others have obviously not read the statute because they would make the argument from a textualist point of view that Congress knew how to focus on sweat laborers and manual laborers because they did in Section 4. But I thought, but why would they have Section 4 in a statute with such different coverage from Section 1? So I looked at the legislative history. And what I found in the legislative history was that every bit of discussion of Sections 1 and 4 indicated they were aimed at the very same class of workers. In other words, this was an integrated statute, which had been my intuition at the beginning, and that every time the sponsor of the legislation talked about Section 4, said it's aimed at exactly the same category of workers that are covered by Section 1. Now, this might be a structural argument for reading Section 1 more narrowly. In other words, choosing a definition of labor that's not as broad as the definition of the critics, and that's more like the definition that the court originally reached. And finally, just as in constitutional interpretation, legislative history might help us think about the purposes and the principles of the statute. and even of broader principles into which the statute is situated. So if there's any ambiguity in Sections 1 coverage or Section 5's exemption, if there's any ambiguity, most interpreters, and the Scalia and Garner book signs onto this entirely, say that you should consider statutory purpose. And as Miranda McGowan has documented, a huge percentage of Justice Scalia's opinions and dissents rely on statutory purpose because he finds ambiguity. Now, the committee reports, so what was the purpose of the Alien Contract Labor Act of 1885? I'm not entirely sure you can figure out what the purpose is just through reading the text, but there's no doubt what the purpose was when you looked at the legislative history, and that was to prevent the flooding of labor markets by the importation of manual workers. It was the purpose that opponents as well as supporters, and so if that was the purpose, a faithful agent, you would think, would interpret labor or service to focus more on manual workers. Holy Trinity, as is notorious, closed with an invocation of the Christian heritage of the country, which went too far, in part because the court did not research the legislative history. If the court had done so, it would have found zero interest in regulating religious speakers of all sorts, would have found the Morgan Amendment, which added the lecturer exemption to protect religious speakers, and that would have saved the court from such a broad Christian minister or Christian heritage thing to focus more on a ministerial thing, as the Supreme Court ultimately did in Hosanna-Tabor versus EEOC. I conclude with this slide. Legislative history might be and often is useful in statutory interpretation for textualists and others alike. It's very useful in understanding text. I did not have a deep understanding of what lecturer meant until I read the legislative history. It's useful in identifying relevant text. The structure of the statute is relevant text. Justice Scalia and other critiques of Holy Trinity didn't even think about Section 4 because they had not either read the statute or looked at the legislative history, which makes it more prominent. And then finally, and most provocatively, I will suggest that preliminary empirical evidence does suggest that legislative history constrains better than pure text-based sources alone. The Brudney and Ditzler, a law professor and political scientist, have found in labor cases that when liberal justices look at legislative history, they vote in a more pro-employer way by a statistically significant margin. When more conservative justices ignore legislative history and just look at the canons, which are judge-made, they vote, maybe not statistically significantly, but they vote in a much more pro-employer way, a way that is more reflective of their predispositions for that reason. And this is very preliminary evidence, but it does suggest that a methodology which seriously considers text read against the background of legislative history might be more constraining than a philosophy that just looks at text read against the background of judicially created canons of statutory interpretation. Thank you very much.
Well, that was a great introduction because I'm going to start with the Church of the Holy Trinity, too, because just about every panel on this topic has to mention that at some point. My goal today is to defend a canon of statutory construction that is considered a fairly infamous canon in both circles of the left and the right, and that's the traditional canon that statutes in derogation of the common law should be construed narrowly. Now, Cass Sunstein, for example, labels this statute obsolete, and that it's something that should not be used in the modern administrative state because, after all, our modern administrative state is based largely on a rejection of common law norms. And if you think that's a harsh criticism, you should hear what Justice Scalia has to say. He calls it a sheer judicial power grab. So he does not mince words. I want to start with the basis of why conservatives or why adherents to textualism tend to care about it. And I think the reason was mentioned by Professor Eskridge, which is that it's not the text itself, but really it's a question about the rule of law. That's ultimately what conservatives are interested in, and that's ultimately what I think drives the movement towards textualism, that the proponents of that want more of a rule of law and less of the rule of judicial preferences. And I think that one of the clear ways in which that goal can be accomplished is not just to think about the text of statutes or even the text of legislative history, but to think of the texts of other law, other sources of law, which I think is actually there's more agreement to that than you would suspect. I'm going to start with the Church of the Holy Trinity because I think that Professor Eskridge gave a great defense of, you know, ways that you could reach the same result in a different way, in a textualist way, perhaps. The thing about the Church of the Holy Trinity is it has nothing in the opinion that says that. It begins by saying it must be conceded that the act of the corporation, meaning the church, is within the letter of this section. And then goes on to say, it is a familiar rule that the thing may be within the letter of the statute and not within the statute because it is not within the spirit or the intention of its makers. And that's its jumping off point. And that's that's why it has become a target of textualism. It's not the result that drives it. It's the analysis that drives it. And I think that in terms of the result, a good comparison to Church of the Holy Trinity is a case, more modern case, NLRB versus Catholic Bishops of Chicago, a case in which I see two thumbs up there. So I know that that's something that many conservatives like and in fact are being used in the courts right now. It's never been overruled. It's not been qualified, and indeed it's being used in modern cases like the EEOC case that was just decided this past year. The key provision in that statute, which is, of course, the National Labor Relations Act, defined the concept of an employer as any person acting as an agent of an employer directly or indirectly, but shall not include, and then there were 8 express exemptions. And the dissent in that case, which was written by Justice Brennan, playing the textualist, said, you know, here's the text of the statute, which is not set forth in the majority opinion, and if you read through this text, it's hard to say that a Catholic school is not an employer. It fits the statutory language relatively easily, and it's not within one of the exceptions. Even if you went to the exceptions section, as many commentators have looked at with Church of the Holy Trinity, you'd say, well, the mere existence of these exemptions tends to reinforce that the rule itself is quite broad and sweeping. Now, of course, the court majority trotted out a powerful weapon, which is the canon of constitutional avoidance. And the first point I want to make about that is, of course, that the court there is looking to another text. It's not common law, but it is a law that is common to our jurisdiction. Now, you might say it's higher law, and therefore that's a justification for bringing that into statutory interpretation. But there's a problem with saying that that's higher law, because this is not the canon of avoiding unconstitutional results. That's a different canon. This is a canon saying that we're going to avoid hard constitutional questions. In other words, we're going to construe statutes away from areas where there might be a serious question. And that's something quite different, because constitutionally, Congress can go into that realm. It's not something that Congress is disabled from going into. So it's hard to see that as necessarily higher law. The more general point, the more important point from Catholic bishops is the court should look to other texts, other common texts in construing statutes. A good example, and if you say I've loaded the dice with the constitutional case, you can move on to FDA versus Brown and Williamson, an opinion joined by all the 5 conservatives on the bench at the time, without dissent or without separate, pardon me, without concurrence among them. With a dissent, obviously. In that case, the question was whether nicotine is a drug and whether cigarettes are a drug delivery device. And if you look at the text of the statute and you stop right there and you consider the health effects of nicotine, and you consider what certainly modern people know about the delivery of nicotine through cigarettes, the case seems to have a fairly strong textual basis. On top of that, the agency that had lost below was not only relying on plain text, they had another canon, the most muscular of canons in their favor, which was the Chevron canon, the canon that says, look, even if it's ambiguous, the courts must defer to reasonable interpretations of the agency. However, the court looked to other texts, specifically other texts that dealt with the problem of cigarettes, and thought that it was not reasonable, the statute clearly did not allow the FDA to enter into this area of regulating cigarettes. And the reason that they made that decision is, I think they thought because of those other statutes, that the broad general language did not address this particular issue. But the mere decision to view those two issues as separate is itself influenced by the broader law, the more general law. I'd say the common law, not common law meaning judge-made, traditional torts and property contract law, but instead the law that's common to the United States. And that's what they got out of the other texts that were involved there. Indeed, one of the other statutes actually declared tobacco to be one of the greatest basic industries of the United States. Now, you know who wrote that. If you have your practice in Washington, you know how that kind of statute gets written. But nonetheless, that is in the United States Code, and that has to be, the Food and Drug Act has to be, the Food, Drug, and Cosmetics Act has to be fit into that structure of text, not just read in isolation. The fourth and last case I want to talk about will actually look at the common law. This is a case that's not usually talked about in the canon of statutory interpretation debates, but it really should be. It's a complex case, and maybe that's why it escapes attention. But it's a case called Bobbs Merrill versus Strauss, which is a case involving what intellectual property lawyers know as the so-called first sale doctrine. And this is a case in which the basic statute, the copyright statute, as it existed at that time, gave the copyright holder the exclusive right to vend copies of the statute. And what the copyright holder did in that case is the copyright holder sold a book and said, put a notice on it that this book cannot be resold below a certain price. The theory of the copyright holder was very clear in terms of this, of the basic text of the statute. The copyright holder theory was, I have the exclusive right for every single sale or vending that takes place. That's what the statute tells me. And anybody who vends my book, anybody who sells it, whether it be the first sale or the second or third or fourth sale, everyone needs a license from me. Everyone needs my permission. And therefore, the statutory language was clear, it was unambiguous, and the theory of the case was very solid. The court, though, looked to general principles of law and thought about how disruptive this would be to the system of property rights in every single state, that suddenly these books, even after they're sold as property, as personal property, would be subject to changes, conditions on the title. And therefore, even though the statute is unqualified and talks about vending or selling, the court viewed the first vending as qualitatively different from every other vending. But there's nothing in the text of that. However, it's the only way the copyright statute can fit into the general law of contract and property without doing enormous damage to the superstructure of those areas. And that, I think, is the final case I'll look at. That is a great case that is still supported by a majority of the court. Even in cases in the copyright area, that doctrine has been codified by statute. But in other areas, like the patent area, it still is just judge-made law. It's judge-made law that still commands unanimity on the Supreme Court. And the reason for that is not because of a policy that they can pull out of the statutes, but because the alternative result would do enormous damage to the superstructure of contract and property law in the states. I want to close by just saying, coming back to the rule of law point, that I think if we need a common law for the age of statutes, to paraphrase or directly quote Judge Calabresi's famous book, I think that common law, we should at least think that it might be the common law. that the common law, the law of contracts, properties, other federal statutes, and the Constitution, the laws that are common, are still relevant for interpreting statutes. And that this is consistent with the rule of law because Congress and its staffs are not trying to rewrite general rules when they pass a statute, unless we have some fairly clear indication that they mean to unsettle entire areas of law. And that supports the virtues of rule of law better than looking at the statute purely in isolation. So I think that disparaged canon has a word or two that should be said in its favor as a more general principle of statutory interpretation. Thank you.
So I'm not going to talk about Holy Trinity. You can thank me later for that. It is really a pleasure to be here. I'm a huge fan of this organization, and I'm just thrilled to be here. And I do think my comments are going to follow quite nicely on John's. What I want to do today is I want to talk about two fundamental claims of textualism and their links to assumptions about how Congress works. So the two claims are this. One, textualism's tools, canons, and text-focused approach are the best way for courts to be faithful agents of the legislature. That is the best way to reflect congressional bargains. And two, that textualism is the best safeguard against judicial lawmaking in the modern statutory age, and particularly in the area of statutes where we're very concerned about legislative supremacy. So the premise of the first claim, that the role of judges is to be faithful agents of the legislature, is surprisingly uncontroversial. I say surprisingly because we've had this long-running debate between textualists and purposivists for years, but everybody kind of agrees the basic premise should be this. We should all try to reflect the legislative bargain. And this relates to the second textualist claim. I think the attraction of that faithful agent premise is from a real modern judicial resistance to the idea of doing anything like lawmaking when it comes to statutes. And so the fight hasn't been over the role of the judge, but how to effectuate it, what the tools should be. It's an empirical fight. Now, of course, we all know this is not the only possible way we could think about statutory interpretation. We could take a pragmatic view, like Judge Posner does, or we could adopt a rule of law approach, which I'm drawn to, and I think a lot of people here would be drawn to, which might take the view that courts really shouldn't try to reflect legislative deals, but instead the role of statutory interpretation doctrine should be to make things predictable, to give notice to the public, to cohere the U.S. code. Now, a lot of you might be saying, well, we textualists already do that. We do believe in the rule of law principle. But the fact of the matter is that we do not have any kind of rule of law approach when it comes to statutory interpretation. Why? Because to have a rule of law approach, courts have to be consistent about which canons apply when, and every judge and practicing lawyer in this room knows that we don't do that right now, right? The court does not apply the same canons to the same statutes every time, even when the same provisions are being construed. And unlike principles of, say, contract interpretation, think the parole evidence rule, unlike principles of even con law interpretation, think tiers of scrutiny, our decision-making regimes for statutory interpretation are not precedential, right? They're not given stare decisis effect. So let me say just one more thing about the rule of law approach. It's true that textualists claim that textualism advances the rule of law, but that claim is almost always tethered to some assumptions about congressional reality. Textualists will say, for example, the idea that Congress uses terms consistently is how Congress drafts and also has this great predictability-enhancing function. But what if, and I'm going to get to the empirical data in a second, what if Congress doesn't actually draft statutory terms consistently? The presumption of textual consistency still affects good values, you know, defensible, rule of law values like predictability. But these are not values that may derive from Congress. That kind of interpretive principle, based on justifiable values, but values that come from courts, not Congress, I think is judicial lawmaking. A consistent usage rule that courts use but that Congress doesn't is a way of judges imposing their own values, good defensible values like coherence, on legislation. Now, as you can tell, I don't think there's anything wrong with that, and I am a federal common law formalist. I'm going to make my case for this in a second. But the point is that the two claims of textualism are linked, right? Textualists claim their methodology reflects Congress, and that lets textualists say that what they're doing when they apply the methodology isn't making law. Now, let me go to the empirics. We've had this decades-old argument about, substantially and empirically grounded argument about which methodology best reflects how Congress makes deals, but we've had almost no empirical testing of how Congress works in relation to these arguments. I recently completed the largest study in history with my co-author, Lisa Bressman of Vanderbilt, of congressional drafters, whether they draft statutes in accordance with the assumptions that courts apply to them. And there's some really interesting news. Some of the big news is that some of the doctrines are getting through to Congress. A lot of our councils who we survey mostly congressional councils, they know Chevron. They know the federalism canon. But our drafters did not know or use many of the presumptions that courts apply, and perhaps most importantly, know but affirmatively reject a bunch of assumptions that courts apply because they're just unrealistic, don't reflect how Congress works. I can give you a lot of examples, but I'll give you just a few that are relevant to textualism, but I should tell you that our findings were as devastating to purposivism in many regards too. This is not a textualism-only set of findings. First, our drafters know but reject the idea that statutory terms are used consistently throughout the U.S. Code, not because of something mushy like intent that textualists might resist, but something structural and formalist, which is the division of Congress into committees, creates siloing across subject matters. Committees don't talk to each other when they draft statutes. Another example, our drafters know the court uses dictionaries when they interpret statutes. They don't use dictionaries when they draft statutes. A third example, I'll go on with that. A third example, they know the rule against superfluities, the idea that Congress doesn't legislate redundancies, but they don't use it because they said that lobbyists often demand to see certain words in statutes, even if it's redundant, and sometimes Congress just legislates to cover the bases for emphasis. A final important example, our drafters know that textualist judges reject legislative history, but our drafters, Republican and Democrat alike, equally across both groups, said that they're still going to use legislative history. It's not going away. It's too important internally to how Congress works. They speak to each other with legislative history. They speak to constituents. They speak to agencies with legislative history. And one more last fact I'm going to leave you with, which is important to this legislative history argument. They pointed out that the statutory text itself is often drafted, most typically drafted, by these nonpartisan drafters in Congress from the offices of House and Senate Legislative Council, right? That members and high-level policy staffs focus on making the deals, and they hand the statutes over to this nonpartisan technician, who, by the way, didn't know the canons either, because we asked them to draft the statutes. Now, this is not the traditional textualist account, right? The textualist account thinks of text as a member's thing. Legislative history is a staff thing. That's not what we heard. So I could go on and on. I hope you'll read the two Stanford Law Review articles that came out of this. But the point should be clear, right? Many of the rules of interpretation don't reflect the drafting process. And a lot of judges claim, and theorists, claim that the democratic legitimacy of those rules comes from the fact that they do reflect that process. So this isn't just a textualism problem, as I said, but because textualists care more about an active judicial role, I think you have to ask yourself this question, right? If the canons of interpretation don't come from Congress, and they don't reflect what Congress drafts or they expect, where do they come from, and what are they trying to do? Right? And this brings me back to the second textualist claim about textualism's limitation on federal judicial common lawmaking. These canons are coming from judges, right? They may have age-old traditions, but I'm a federal common law formalist. I don't believe in general law like John alluded to, right? These canons are federal common law, right? They're being made by judges. A few of them, like the federalism canon, may be thought of as quasi-constitutional law because they have constitutional underpinnings, but they're not con law because they can be overruled by Congress. Congress can preempt, it just has to do so clearly. So let me link this common law idea to a few other familiar Federalist debates. There's a raging debate in the international law context about whether courts should construe statutes in conjunction with the Charming Betsy canon, right? This idea that statutes are construed in accordance with customary international law. Textualists and Federalists alike have stood firm against this canon because it's not congressionally derived, it's judge-made law. But amazingly, no one has made the link between that debate and the debate of statutory interpretation, where we have more than 100 of those kinds of canons that we could be talking about. And perhaps even more amazingly, as every lawyer and judge in here knows, textualists love those 100 canons, right? And a lot of those canons can't be anything other than judge-made policy. Now, you can say superfluities, the linguistic canons, well, those are just common sense linguistic presumptions. They're not law. But I submit you can't say that about the canon that ambiguities in bankruptcy statute are construed in favor of the debtor, or ambiguities in the tax statutes are narrowly construed, or the 60 other canons of such nature that you'll find in Eskridge's fabulous casebook in the appendix. So let me say something. Those canons are frequently employed. They don't have an age-old pedigree, and they're created by judges. So let me just conclude by saying, I don't think this is a problem, even though I believe in our doctrines of federal common lawmaking. The problem, I think, is that we're not honest about where these things are coming from, what they're doing, and what that says about the role of courts in the modern administrative state. The prohibition from federal common lawmaking comes from the Erie case, my favorite case, actually. But Erie was from a different time, and it's about a different problem, right? Erie is about state law, versus federal law. Should federal judges make their own law when there's already state law to take? That's not what we're talking about here in the domain of statutory interpretation. We're in the domain of federal law. We're not going to go to 50 states' different laws to interpret a federal statute. We've got nowhere else to go, and I think the court should be comfortable recognizing that they're making law when they're applying these rules. Now, look, there is another way we can go. We can say, well, Erie told federal courts to look to the states for law, so where should we look when we're interpreting statutes? Let's look to Congress. Let Congress come up with a federal law of statutory interpretation that will bind courts, as Nick Rosenkranz suggested about 10 years ago. Now, most practicing judges who have addressed this idea very strongly resist it, including Justice Scalia. And so I don't think it really is the case that judges want these statutory interpretation principles to come from Congress after all, right? If the rules are supposed to reflect congressional practice, why shouldn't Congress be able to dictate them or change them? I don't think federal judges really want to give Congress that kind of power. And this raises a whole host of separate, very interesting questions about what it is about these principles that seem so personal to federal judges, why they don't want to let anybody else have power over them. I've written about that elsewhere and can't discuss that here. But what I'm going to conclude with is to say this. I don't think anyone, textualists or purposivists alike, can ignore the empirical evidence. If textualism is truly based on the idea that it's supposed to reflect how Congress drafts or what Congress expects, then the doctrines need to be updated in light of empirical work. As it stands, the rules are disconnected from how Congress works. You know, a different option is to consider that the courts might actually be engaged in a different kind of project, right? There may be systemic, notice, coherence, constitutional, you choose, different kinds of values that are actually animating what courts are doing. Again, I don't think there's anything wrong with that, but I do think we need to be honest about where these doctrines come from, what they're doing, in order to understand the power of courts in the modern regulatory state and what the role of these doctrines really are. Thanks.
Well, I want to thank Dean Reuter and David Ray and for inviting me to participate in this very distinguished panel. The members of this panel have written some of the seminal works on statutory interpretation, and I'm happy to be here to share my latest effort in this regard. I want to talk a little bit today about why textualists should have a theory of legislative history and why that theory should resist purposivism's tendency to look out over the crowd and find their friends at the cocktail party. Now, let me say that one of the reasons you need this theory is because, as we've seen from Professor Eskridge's opening remarks, textualism is a bit more complicated than you might think. It is possible, as I've demonstrated recently in the Yale Law Journal, that there are competing texts in any statutory interpretation case, and then the question becomes, is one picking and choosing one's friends at the textualist cocktail party? So let us assume we have an ambiguous statute or a conflict in texts, and assume, as I was once a lawyer at the Justice Department, that you're faced with an opponent invoking legislative history. My contention is that up until recently, no one has focused on what Professor Gluck and other people are focused on in terms of looking at how Congress actually works. Now, I have a slightly different view. I think the idea that our present Congress is going to do what Professor Rosenkranz, my colleague, suggested many years ago and pass rules of statutory interpretation, the likelihood of that is almost nil. Nevertheless, I think that under existing rules, we can learn some things that can constrain the purposivists from picking and choosing their friends at the purposivist cocktail party. So, in a decision theory of statutory interpretation published in the Yale Law Journal in 2012, I argue for a theory of legislative history that is simple, parsimonious, and specific because it focuses not on purpose but on text. It restrains the willy-nilly use of legislative history. It's a cocktail party there. It suggests there are rules for Congress, and there are. This is not working very well. Where am I supposed to do this? And did I miss one? No. And in fact, legislative history and its use have changed. Technology has upended the argument that looking for legislative history is too difficult. You can use Control F and find the term lecturer rather easily in the debates on Holy Trinity. And it's through things like ProQuest Congressional. And no, they did not pay me to come here today. All right, decision theory follows and starts with the text. Textualists have always conceded that you begin and that you can look at transformations and amendments to the language of the text. And this is where my approach starts. It means you have to track this closely to see where there are changes in language. But to do that, you really need to learn how to read the congressional record. And these are my injunctions for you in terms of reading the congressional record. Now, you know that I used to work for the Senate. I'm one of those unreliable, manipulative teenagers who used to work for the Senate Judiciary Committee. I'd actually was about 30 and had argued many cases in the courts of appeal, but I digress. First thing, no driving while blind. If you can't read a trial transcript without knowing the basic forms of a trial, you don't need to know 27 hearsay exceptions, but you do need to know that pleadings come before jury instructions. The same thing is true with respect to Congress. A committee report is not the same as a conference committee report. A conference committee report comes at the end, not the beginning. It does different things. There are different rules that apply to them. I don't believe committee reports, which it's the standard rule that these are the best gold standard legislative history, that's baloney. Why? They come at the beginning of the process, and all the real stuff comes at the end. Which is why my theory is essentially reverse engineering and makes it simpler to look at legislative history because you don't have to look at necessarily everything that happened before the text arrives in final form. So my first injunction is no driving while blind. Know something about the principles that govern the sequential project of lawmaking. Now, this does not mean you have to become a parliamentarian, nor do you even have to read the rules of the House and the Senate. You do have to be slightly more sophisticated than the schoolhouse rock version, which is wrong because it also says that bills are drafted in committee and now they're not. What it used to be unorthodox lawmaking is now conventional. But I can describe this process to you in about 5 to 10 minutes. It's not difficult. It's not physics. All right, so no driving while blind. Distinguish winners from losers, okay? Statutes are like elections. You need 60 votes in the Senate. It's a super majoritarian system. And that may have great virtues, like John McGinnis is arguing in his book on the good constitution and originalism. It's largely reliant on super majoritarianism as giving you a great pedigree for the legitimacy of the Constitution. And here I would say you really need to pay attention to winners and losers because often a tiny minority in the Senate can filibuster. And if you are citing the filibuster minority's statements, and this happens by liberals as well as conservatives, that can't possibly be the meaning of the statute. Everyone knows you can cite dissents, but you have to give a justification. The dissent can't possibly be the ruling of the court. And that's all I'm asking for, principle number two. All right. Target the text. Purposivists like to point to their friends. So-and-so said there was one purpose. Another person said there was another purpose. It's very difficult. And in fact, you end up, as Judge Easterbrook famously wrote in a brilliant article, Statutes Domains, you end up expanding the range of the statute by definition. So you want to start by targeting the text. Focus, focus, focus. And you can follow this through computer techniques. It's very easy now to do that. Finally, read backwards. The key compromises, the ones that are the most difficult, happen at the end, right before cloture. And cloture happens on every bill now. This is why you can't pay attention to the schoolhouse rock version. Even when I was a staffer in the early 90s, the first rule on the first day I came in, I learned was I needed to count to 60. All right? And those things happen at the end. Why? Before you get a cloture vote, you need to know you got 60 votes. Why waste anybody's time? So you got 60 votes, and how do you get them? You compromise. So before you have the 60 votes, you have a substitute bill. That substitute bill is where the rubber hits the road. That's the text for all purposes that will go forward, and it can be amended in the 30 hours after that. But that's the central textual compromise. And that's where you need to start. Now, I'm going to give you an example of this, a case called Public Citizen versus ABA, which involves the ABA's judicial advice on judicial nominees to the president. This is a sunshine law. Any committee established or utilized by the president must open its records, set public meetings, etc. Now, as the Supreme Court recognized, this might include the president's own party, the NAACP, AARP, and as I say to my students, it might include Sasha and Malia at breakfast with the president if they give him advice on tattoos or whatever they're giving him advice on. Utilize is an extravagantly vague term. Was the ABA covered when the ABA gives its advice on judicial nominees as they are qualified, not qualified, etc.? Now, let's see. Under my theory, how are you going to go about looking at this statute? Well, first of all, you know you're going to start with the text established or utilized. Are you going to start with the 10-year process in terms of legislative history, which someone will go to, right? Because established or utilized, some people said, was absurd. Are you going to go through the 10-year process of trying to pass this law? No. Don't bother. Are you going to write a history which sets forth the debate pro and con on the bill? I mean, this is often how legislative history is written. No. Are you going to look for the key text? You betcha. You're going to look for utilize. Where the heck did utilize come from? That's your mission. Are you going to be driving while blind? Absolutely not. You are going to know the rules, and you're going to find out where that text came from. And lo and behold, guess what? It came in the conference committee. Now, what is a conference committee? Well, the House passes Bill A, and the Senate passes a different bill, and they come to conference to try and reconcile. Under the rules, you can't add significant new matter to the bill. Now, why would that be? Because the people at the conference are typically agenda setters, and they're going to come in there, and they're going to undo what the supermajority did. So this rule actually has some teeth, particularly in highly salient circumstances. On the other hand, people often use it to sort of fix details and other things, and there's a rule that deals with that. In general, the rules say you are not to treat, without objection, matters in the legislative history of a conference report as substantially different from the underlying bills. Because in fact, what will happen if you add utilize in the statute at that point, it will only have passed two houses. So, bottom line, the only relevant legislative history is not the 13-year history of these sunshine laws. It is one report, it is one term, and the key move is to focus how an average member of Congress, as Justice Scalia has said, would interpret the term utilize, and they would interpret it to not significantly modify establish. You do not, as the Supreme Court said in this case, have to deal with absurdity. You don't have to hold it unconstitutional, as Justice Kennedy would have held. You can simply find out in a very parsimonious way where this term came from, and using Congress's rules of interpretation, you can come to a much easier and restrained conclusion. Thank you very much.
This is the third panel with textualism in its title. I am the 12th speaker. I'm so happy all of you have stayed. You don't have to listen to anybody after me. Well, there'll be some exchange, but we promise no more panels. The key to understanding the role of text in statutory interpretation lies in answering the question, what justifies a judicial claim to override the decisions of other public officials and all private actors? When a judge rejects a president's interpretation of a statute, or tells a private party to pay $10 million or go to prison, what kind of reason must the judge give? The statement, on balance, I think my conclusion wise, is, well, a conclusion, not a reason. The Constitution gives courts the judicial power of the United States. What's a judicial power? It's one that's been authorized, sometimes by the Constitution itself, sometimes by legislation. Political actors trace their claims to elections, judges trace their claims to texts. Provenance matters. And in the United States, text means congressional enactment, ratification of a treaty, right? You've got the list. For statutes, both houses of Congress plus the president, validity comes from provenance, not from intent and not from pragmatic benefit. The text is the law, not evidence of some deeper law. That's textualism in a nutshell, and the understanding leads to a theory of interpretation that relies on objective public signs. Wittgenstein showed that there is no private intent in communication generally. Limits on the validity of enactment and the judicial power show that that's doubly so for legal interpretation. Justice Holmes put the point with his usual flair, and I'm going to quote him briefly. A statute does not disclose one meaning conclusively according to the laws of language. Thereupon we ask not what this man meant, but what those words should mean in the mouth of a normal speaker of English, using them in the circumstances in which they were used. But the normal speaker of English is merely a special variety, a literary form, so to speak, of our old friend the prudent man. He's external to the particular writer, and a reference to him as a criterion is simply another instance of the externality of the law, close quote. Ronald Dworkin proposed that judges treat statutory texts as the first chapter of a chain novel, which judges could complete according to their own lights. He proposed having ethical claims dominate the later chapters. Others proposed pragmatic solutions. But suppose an agency said that although its statute didn't give it a particular power, it was quite sure that its rules serve the public interest, so they should be enforced. A judge would laugh. In the United States, authority depends on consent of the governed, which is to say, approval through the prescribed forms, not on claims to have a good decision. That's why judges regularly set aside unauthorized agency action. That's why President Truman lost the Steele seizure case. His solution may have been best, all things considered, but it had not been authorized. And Congress lost the One House veto case for the same reason. What judges say about other public officials, that the validity of their acts depends on authorization through the Constitution's procedures rather than pragmatic benefits, is equally true of judges themselves. This must drive judges to rely on approved texts, not on private intents imputed to legislators or on consequentialist arguments. One upshot for this understanding is demoting legislative history, and I'll come back to what I mean by demoting. What committees and individual legislators say isn't approved by a majority of each chamber or signed by the president, so it isn't law. But statements may be useful to the extent they show how persons living at the time of enactment used words. That is, for their objective force, just as dictionaries may be useful even though they haven't passed both houses of Congress and been signed by the president. Another consequence of this understanding is that judges use simple rules rather than complex ones. Frederick Schauer observed 20 years ago that experts in a field, say ERISA specialists, may understand the statute and regulations differently from the way judges do. I think that's equally true of people who really understand Congress well. They may see things differently from the way judges do. But in exercising a judicial power, judges have to approach texts the way normal readers external to the legislature do. Addressees of laws are the appropriate interpretive community. And this simplification has the benefit of giving judges a task they can do. Academics and editorial writers sometimes depict judges as philosophers with ample time to study, reflect, and act wisely. a very nice article by Professors Rodriguez and Weingast proposed dealing with statutes by looking at where the real sticking points were in the legislature and distinguishing cheap talk from costly talk using the legislature's own rules for what talk was cheap and what talk was costly. And they applied that approach to a single statutory enactment. Their article was more than 100 pages long, and it came out more than 30 years after the statute was enacted. Judges can't devote that amount of study to distinguishing cheap talk from costly talk. Judges are busy generalists. I decide more than 300 cases a year. The time available for each issue is short. The textualist approach limits the damage judges can inflict on the rest of us. First, do no harm is as good a rule for judges as it is for physicians. Still a third result of the provenance-based approach to interpretation is that judges must implement statutes as understood when enacted. It's the interpretive community alive at the time of the text's adoption that supplies the objective benchmark of meaning. Updating approaches, which tend to emphasize the community alive at the time of the law's enforcement, aren't textualist. They are Ronald Dworkin's chain novel by another name. To say that if Congress were to revisit the subject today, it would say X, is not to show that the judiciary would do X. What Congress would do, but hasn't done, it hasn't done, and there's no authority. Congress acts by, well, enacting things and getting presidents to sign them, not by thinking, and certainly not via homunculi in the judicial mind. Claims about what the current Congress, or for that matter, the enacting Congress, would or could have done are fantasies. Judges tend to impute to these phantom assemblies whatever the judges themselves think wise. If a judge can't supersede a statute by saying, X would be better, the judge can't supersede a statute by saying, I'm sure that the current Congress would have thought that X would be better. When Bill Eskridge says, as he is wont to say, we are all textualists now, what he really means is that the legal process school, to the extent it exalted purposes imputed to legislatures, is dead. We do not agree, however, have agreement on his proposal for allowing statutes to be updated by asking the current interpretive community what it wants. Our time is short, but before closing, I want to say a few words about the conclusions of Abby Gluck and Victoria Nurse. They are careful students of the legislative process. They find that many of the interpretive norms used by textualists do not reflect legislators' actual behavior, and the severely limited knowledge of both the legislators and their staffs. A judge, and me, who has just proclaimed that the judiciary operates with little time and a shortfall of knowledge, would be hard-pressed to attribute omniscience to legislators. I'm happy to agree with the factual conclusions that Professors Gluck and Nurse reach. I admire their work, and I've learned a great deal from it. But what follows? The suggestion that interpretation should track the internal processes of legislatures is a version of the private meaning argument that Wittgenstein showed is problematic for all communication, and that the Constitution rules out for the judicial branch. We need an objective approach, which is to say an external approach. So, for example, both the House and the Senate publish legislative drafting manuals. Judges largely overlook them. They really ought to be consulted. They're external to the process of adopting any bill. Judges should be looking at those things because they tell us what a particular drafting structure tells us about legislation. If Congress were to enact the federal code of judicial interpretation, as Professor Rosenkrantz suggested, I, at least, for one, would be delighted because that would provide us authentic, external, objective indicators. But we have to be very worried about trying to interpret things by imputing internal understandings. Judges ought, I agree, judges ought to avoid using interpretive precepts that rest on misunderstandings about how legislatures work. But many of the standards in textual interpretation don't rest on views about what legislatures actually do, nor should they, since the standard is supposed to be objective and external. They rest on an as-if approach. take the norm that the new law will be understood as if legislators knew what already is in the United States Code and the United States reports. Resolving ambiguity so that the new statute fits rather than repeals something else by implication. The assumption is, of course, false. Legislators don't know the contents of the code or the U.S. reports, and neither do judges. But the assumption is better than the opposite one, under which judges impute systematic ignorance to legislatures and infer a jumble of inconsistent and conflicting rules. That would injure the law's addressees in ways that no one set out to create. Far better to use the as-if assumption under which it pays legislators to learn the legal landscape rather than to ignore it. And if that means that a judge has to plead guilty to making up a rule external to the legislature, I do plead guilty. Until Congress passes the Federal Rules of Statutory Interpretation, the canons come from outside, whether there are 100 or, as Scalia and Garner said, only 57 good ones and 13 bad ones. I will not try to discuss either the 57 good ones or the 13 bad ones. We can talk about them in the discussion period. For now, my message is that judges have to justify their acts with something other than a claim to good consequences. And the process of interpretation should be as objective and as simple as possible. Judges can never be free of their own druthers, but the best interpretation is system of interpretation is one that makes self-indulgence a sin rather than a cause for celebration. Thank you.
Any response? Anyone on the panel want to say a few words before we open it up?
A very few words. Just to respond a little bit to Gluck, Nurse, and Easterbrook. And that is to say the following, that we were assigned to talk about textualism, and we did, and we talked about legislative history. But don't be deluded into thinking that a theory of statutory interpretation can be textualism, purposivism, legislative historyism. Because at least in our system, you cannot have a theory of statutory interpretation, in my opinion, without including a role for precedent. Because any statute that's around for a while is going to generate precedent. It's going to generate agency precedent. It's going to generate practice in the affected communities. And it's going to generate, at least in many cases, judicial precedent when judges are involved. And so as we go over time, Holy Trinity was decided very soon after the statute was passed. We've been mainly talking about the statutes whose interpretation rapidly follows, and I think that's a very useful exercise. But I would suggest that when you talk about statutes over time, the Sherman Act being a dramatic example, that the statute really does change in dramatic ways, maybe even in a common law way, if judicial interpretations or agency interpretations start dominating the original deals or the original meaning of the text that you might have. And I'll give you as Exhibit A to that. Justice Scalia wrote a whole book on Holy Trinity, and I don't believe he read the entire statute. And I certainly think that the part of the statute he did read, the labor or service of any kind, he really read through the lens of someone in the 1980s and 1990s, more than if he'd been someone in the 1880s when the statute was actually passed. So I would introduce that as a note of complexity, and I would also suggest that statutory interpretation in the hard cases, like Sweet Home versus Babbitt, as well as Holy Trinity, is usually a very complicated endeavor indeed.
I'll just say one thing which I think is very important. We've talked a lot about why judges should or should not read legislative history, but I think that one point is that lawyers often should read legislative history, because oftentimes you will find things in the legislative history that do point to other principles of law that the legislature is not trying to overturn, and that you can come up with an objective, simple objective argument to explain why the statute doesn't overturn that background principle. But if unless you read the legislative history, or you're omniscient, you might not think of it. You might not think of it, but the legislative history itself is written by people who know a lot about this statute and at least have some idea how it's supposed to work with other things. So even if you think you're going to appear before a judge who will not peek at the legislative history, lawyers often should, because it's a very good source for ideas about how this fits with other features of law. I could give examples of that, but I'll leave it at that.
I just want to offer three quick comments on Judge Easterbrook's great presentation, which I agree almost every word of what he said. The first thing I want to say is that I want people to recognize how sort of radical what he said was, even though it sounds perfectly reasonable. Judge Easterbrook offered a much less congressionally tethered theory of interpretation that most judges actually say they're engaging in, right? He's looking at an outside audience, the public, the reasonable man, not the individual legislature. I think that is a rule of law approach. It's saying that for reasons like efficiency, simplicity, right, we have to come up with a set of rules in which we can coordinate systemic behavior. I agree with that argument, but that is a new or not a common way of justifying what textualism or purposivism is about. I just wanted to point that out. Two quick facts, because I don't want anybody to leave with any misimpressions. Don't look at the Office of Legal Counsel drafting manuals, please, because I love the idea of going to objective data inside Congress, but this just shows how difficult it is. Our study showed that those manuals aren't actually used by a lot of drafters in Congress, only by the legislative councils. The House and Senate drafting manuals aren't even consistent with each other. The Senate Commerce Committee has its own different manual. So this is why, A, we need more study of Congress, but also, B, why maybe a faithful agent theory isn't really possible, right? And third, Justice Scalia's 57 canons did not mention any of the subject-related canons of interpretation, tax, bankruptcy, all of those subject-specific canons, a glaring omission that makes one wonder whether he didn't quite know what to do with them, because we know he knows about them. So that's where I'll leave that.
I just want to make one remark. Yes, I agree that there are, it appears, and I just heard this, I was presenting a paper at Yale a couple days ago, that judges and lawyers panic at the thought of understanding how Congress works. It's all a garbage can. I have to say that if you assume it's a garbage can, it will always be a garbage can. There are some rules. You can't have a body, a collective body that size, without something like Jefferson recommended, which is Robert's Rules of Order. Every meeting follows Robert's Rules of Order. So to know that there are some rules seems to be appropriate for a rule-based approach, and one which is faithful to Congress. Now, as I said, you don't have to be a parliamentarian, and you don't have to be an intentionalist to understand those rules. I don't believe you should look at a single senator's view. I don't think you should try to get into the minds of folks. It's very difficult if you are a very precise, highly trained lawyer to imagine the kind of incentives you have when you're trying to appeal to the Fifth of Alaska or the Fourth District in Alabama. It's a very different mindset. You don't have to be an intentionalist. And I just gave a paper at Yale that was about that point. To look at these very few rules that can help to make easy some very hard cases under the canons. So I urge you to think about that. I also don't think you should look at the manuals, because I disagree with Professor Gluck on one point. The people in the Legislative Council's office think they draft statutes, but they don't. Everyone in Washington thinks they draft statutes. Lobbyists will tell you they draft statutes. Senators will tell you they draft statutes. Staffers will tell you they draft statutes. And in fact, the Legislative Council's office is very good. It's a bipartisan body. But for a variety of reasons involving sequencing, okay? What happens at the end, they won't be involved at the end. They might be involved at the beginning, but they're not going to be involved at the end. And so I don't think that that's necessarily the best place to start. It might be in a, you know, sort of technical case, but in a case where there's a very controversial provision, it's unlikely that they are the last word.
I'm done. Let's go to the floor.
All right. To the floor it is. Now, we only have one rule, as Judge Smith mentioned in the last session, and that rule is there has to be a question. We have panelists who are experts, who are here to give the commentary, to give the answers. So no one who comes forward should be disguised as a panelist. You're here to ask a question. Mr. Ansel.
Hi, I'm Fred Ansel with the Senate Judiciary Committee.
Who has a question?
I read this week a review of a new book of that's been just been published of all of Learned Hand's letters. And I think he's someone that I think just about everyone in this room and in many other organizations would say was one of the greatest judges of our history. He did not interpret statutes the way any of you are recommending that statutes be interpreted. I've read many of his decisions. He talks about purpose all the time. He doesn't cite legislative history a lot, and he doesn't read the text necessarily in the way that any of you said. And yet he's considered one of the greatest judges who interpreted statutes ever. Why today does no one follow his approach to interpreting statutes? And is he, in fact, not a very good statutory interpreter? What changed? What happened?
May I have a...
I'll tell you why I don't follow his approach. It's because it's not an approach to interpreting statutes. It's an approach to replacing statutes with something that's better. Learned Hand is a very smart guy, and often he was better than Congress. But, but his approach, which he interpreted to Aristotle and sometimes gets called imaginative reconstruction, was to say, I'd like to imagine how Congress would have solved this problem if they'd thought about it with the degree of concreteness that it's now presented to me. Since the Congress is no longer available to speak for itself, Learned Hand speaks for that Congress. And guess what he says? What he says is, well, what he thinks is a wise outcome. It's one reason why the view among many lawyers at the time was, quote, Learned, but follow Gus. It's the other hand.
That's right. I just want to say one quick thing about that. Justice Scalia, in his book, recent book, acknowledged that he is a purposivist to the extent that he looks at the text of the statute and looks for purpose. Everyone's a purposivist and everyone's a textualist, which means that legislative history is the only ground distinguishing them. The other thing I'd like to say is just that Learned Hand was a great judge. I clerked for a judge who knew Learned Hand, called him B for Billings Learned Hand, his first name, along with Professor Eskridge, and I clerked for the same judge. And it is true that, in fact, his imaginative reconstruction theory is really a theory, as I have argued, of statutory construction. You've heard in the originalist debates about the difference between statutory interpretation and statutory construction. All right, and this is what Judge Easterbrook was just mentioning. It is adding something to the statute that does not appear on the face of the statute, and that is why it has come under some disrepute.
Let me add to that, and I won't say look, Ma, no hands anymore, but it is true that Learned and Gus were of a different era. They were of an era, Learned Hand was a great common law judge. Even in constitutional cases, he was a great common law judge. And you could be a great common law judge in that period. Not that there weren't statutes. The statutes tended to be shorter. They tended to be vaguer. And the common law reasoning was still sort of en vogue. That is not the case anymore. We live in what we call a republic of statutes. The statutes are not only numerous, they're detailed. And the primary interpreters were not Learned Hand, and they're not Dick Posner and Frank Easterbrook. Primary interpreters are agencies, right? To the extent they're official interpreters of statutes, it's 90%+ agencies. And judges only come in as backstops. So that's reason number one, that he was a great common law judge and his approach reflected a great sort of common law thing. But the second really is jurisprudential, is that he was really a pre-Erie judge. And Erie and the discovery of scarcity in the 1968 election. You know, he was a great New Deal judge, Learned Hand was. And the idea of elaborating on a statute and expanding a statute was less questionable in Learned Hand's era. And so Frank Easterbrook is right. You need some kind of greater justification today than you did then. Whether it's going to be the text or democracy or the legislature, we hold judges to that tether much more. And then finally, Learned Hand was a pre-Brown versus Board of Education judge. We were not obsessed in the Learned Hand era with the counter-majoritarian difficulty. nearly as much as we are today. I could give you dozens of other reasons, but three is always sufficient.
I'll pass it along. All
right. Well, we're going to follow. There's a question from the back. All right.
Yeah, I couldn't make it up to the front with the spread, so I took advantage of the microphone back here. Paul Kaminar, I have a question for Professor Gluck, I believe, who mentioned the public citizen versus Department of Justice case. That case is near and dear to me since I argued the case in the Supreme Court on behalf of the Washington Legal Foundation, which was the original plaintiff, public citizen, to intervene. And the reason it's called public citizen, they filed their cert petition the day before I did.
Okay, Paul.
But my question
is...
Get a question? The utilization, I think, it was mischaracterized because it wasn't broadly... it's a broad term to be sure, but there was case law that narrowed it. There were regulations that narrowed it. You had the State Department have an advisory committee on ambassadors on their qualifications. And what the majority did was to avoid constitutional avoidance by avoiding the separation of powers. So don't you think that the majority was disingenuous to artificially narrow the term utilized, and that the dissent, Justice Kennedy, said, look, it's clear it's utilized, but we're going to have to reach the constitutional issue, namely separation of powers violation?
I also argued a case for the Bush Justice Department involving this, and I didn't think what I now think about the case. I agree that there are conventional ways of looking at it in light of precedent, et cetera. But under this theory, there's a much easier way to do it. Justice Brennan committed judicial surgery. His majority opinion is not defensible. So if that's not defensible, then of course you go to the constitutional argument made by Justice Kennedy. And I think it's a pretty good constitutional argument. I think there's a way for judges to be more restrained than going in either direction, judicial surgery or constitutional adjudication. And that is by finding out, well, if you were the average congressperson, you would follow a rule that said utilize doesn't mean anything different than establish, which is essentially what Justice Brennan did, but he did it through the wrong means.
Next question. We're going to follow the tradition from the last session. We have one of my former law clerks ask the question.
My question is primarily for Judge Easterbrook, because I know you've written on this subject matter. Professor Duffy mentioned some of the problems with the canon of what I'll call the constitutional doubt. But is even the narrower canon of constitutional avoidance consistent with textualism to the extent that it sort of elides the idea that there is one objective meaning of the text that is best?
I think the constitutional doubt canon and the constitutional avoidance canon are two different canons. The constitutional avoidance canon, I would state as, if you've got a reasonable choice between reading the statute in a way that's consistent with the Constitution and reading the statute in a way that makes it invalid, choose the one that's consistent with the Constitution, on the assumption that Congress would rather have done something than nothing. Maybe false in fact, but that at least gives some respect to the other branches of government. The constitutional avoidance canon is a canon based on an idea of judicial laziness. It says, gee, let's assume that Congress didn't mean us to do our jobs and figure out whether its statute was actually within its power. Henry Friendly responded to that by saying, do you think anybody in Congress believes that? Congress likely thinks that that's what judges are for, is deciding whether something is within their power. This constitutional doubt canon, since there are emanations and penumbras around almost every part of the Constitution, pretty much gives judges license to do as they please with legislation. And that's not consistent with the theory of interpretation that I was articulating. Professor Gluck is right. In a sense, my theory is different from other theories of textualism. The Scalia and Garner book praises the constitutional doubt canon, whereas I've written saying it is a canon that should be jettisoned immediately.
The back.
This question is for Judge Easterbrook.
We can't hear it.
It's for Judge Easterbrook, he said.
Can you hear now?
The question.
Yes.
Okay. So this is about clarifying what it means to find the original public meaning of the text. So at the beginning, you mentioned, you sort of described it as what would these words coming out of the mouth of an objectively reasonable person, what would he mean by those words? And then sort of later on, you also mentioned it in terms of what would a reasonable reader, what would they understand the words to mean if they were reading the words. And I wonder if it's worth making sort of clarifying which one of those two, if they're the same or if they're, if there's any difference between them. And in particular, I'm thinking textualist usage of semantic canons, so like sort of, you know, rules of thumb about how reasonable people use language. It seems sort of to be the first one that you mentioned, how, you know, what a person would mean by those words coming out of his mouth.
Well, I didn't get into that, and time is much too short to get into that. The point I wanted to get across is that to have an objective theory of interpretation, you need to define an interpretive community external to the legislature. That sometimes could be a community of specialists. One of my favorite cases is a case that set a tax on fruit, and an import duty on fruit, and the question then arises whether a tomato is a vegetable or a fruit. And that depends, of course, on who the interpretive community is. You get one answer from a community of botanists and another answer from a community of grade schoolers. And the Supreme Court of the United States held that Congress was more like grade schoolers than like botanists. And that may be entirely accurate, but it can be difficult to choose the right community, and that's why I wanted to avoid it. Time is short.
Okay. Question.
So once upon a time, there was Sutherland on statutory construction. And as Professor Nurse has pointed out, there is a difference, at least in Sutherland, between statutory construction and statutory interpretation. And of course, there's also parliamentary law, which is most importantly the majoritarian principle. But several years ago, Senator Fred Thompson appeared before a panel, I think in this very room, and talked about the legislative process and said the following, summarizing it in a few seconds, that in his experience, Congress often would enact legislation, but at difficult points, use extremely vague and ambiguous language by design to compromise on various issues. My question to the panel is simply, assuming a legislative report like that, that the language used has been deliberately made ambiguous or vague to achieve some sort of compromise, how would the panel treat such an issue or such a problem?
Well, it's most likely either an implicit, if not an explicit, delegation of the filling in gaps to another organ, and very often to an agency. Remember, the baseline is no longer learned hands' baseline. The baseline in the Republic of Statutes is agencies. And even the Sherman Act, where the courts have the final word, if you look, as Doug Ginsburg has done in a recent article, at the actual behavior of the US Supreme Court for the last 40 years in Sherman Act cases, they have almost always followed the leadership of the Department of Justice in the Antitrust Division. So in other words, even where courts are ostensibly the gap-filling interpreters, they usually follow the leadership of the administrative agencies, okay? So it seems to me that's effectively what's done. Now that's subject to the last panel, which talked about the non-delegation doctrine, and at some point, as in the FDA tobacco case and other cases that you could talk about, the courts will draw the line and say, agency, you've taken this broad terminology too far, and for various reasons, we're not going to let you regulate tobacco in that particular case. Because mm-hmm. there you also had very broad terminology. So it's not unlimited.
I just think that that is a perfect example of where you do want to use the canon that you're trying to fit whatever they did, no matter how vague it is, into the superstructure of the law, the general superstructure of the law, with the least amount of damage. I think an objective observer would take that view. And I think the intention, if you were an intentionalist, would also say that they don't mean as much damage as you could read a vague term. They don't quite understand how broadly lawyers can read those terms. And that's why I think trying not to do, as Judge Easterbrook said, do no harm is a good rule.
Okay, so I actually disagree with that. I think that in that case, the judge reading in sort of a common law doctrine is judges stepping in and making, judges making decisions. I think that's a fine way to go, but we need to be honest about that's what's happening. If you want some quick empirical data, in our study, 90-something percent of 137 councils said that ambiguity is intentional, as you say, because you can't get to compromise. Only something like 30% of them said they would want the courts to resolve that kind of ambiguity. 90-something percent said they want agencies to decide that kind of ambiguity. But the question is, if you're going to bring in those common law doctrines, we just have to be honest about what we're doing, that we're bringing in a set of common law doctrines to resolve these kinds of ambiguities.
Right. Last word. Yeah,
just one brief observation. Judges see those kinds of vague clauses everywhere. It seems to me important not then to try to impute to the legislature more than was there. If there's a delegation there to an agency or the agency or the court should be saying, I'm now going to make the following rules because power has been delegated. But searching for an answer in something that doesn't have any answer leads only to weird and unpredictable consequences.
Please join me in thanking our panel.
What a fun panel, huh?